examples about how a particular legal norm can influence economic development. Now, you perhaps know what private property is. Basically, you know, basically I think everybody knows what private property is. But to repeat it for you, private property means that the owner of the property has an undivided right about using this property, appropriating the fruits of the property, selling the property, using the property as a pledge, as a mortgage, for instance, and giving up the property or renting out the property. So you can basically, all competences which the law can attach to the property are concentrated in one person. That is basically the concept of property. But this is, of course, not the only concept of a property right, a right related to property. Another very important, in the Middle Ages, very important legal institutions was the manor, the noble people. They, the way the law attributed rights to them was very much different from private property. So you can look at it in the following way. Now, assume you have a large plot of land, and then you have the noble, the master, the noble man, and then you have all these people working on the land. Now, under the manor system, these people working on the land, they are not workers who work for a salary or a wage. They are not wage owners, but they are co-owners of the, now it's not the right word, they have a right to work for this land. The land provides them with a secure working place, with a secure job. But they work on the land and the lord of the manor gets, let's say, 50% of the crop. So that is what you call in India sharecropping, but this is a property system. Now, this sharecropping system came under critique and under stress. For hundreds of years it worked smoothly. But in the 18th century, there were innovations, agricultural innovations. I cannot go into the details, but if one invested heavily into the agriculture, with steel plows, not wooden plows, but steel plows and so on, one could increase substantially. Now, one of the greatest economists of the 18th century, François Quesnay, I don't know whether you ever heard that name, the economist perhaps, he was a French economist, and he observed that the French agriculture was totally undercapitalized. So the French agriculture did not make use, unlike the British agriculture, of steel plows, of horses. Also, steel plows have to be carried by horses. So all this is a very high investment. A horse is, even today, costs 12,000 euros or something. And in the 18th century, it was a huge investment. So what Quesnay observed in Britain, in Flanders, in Holland, they had all these investments made, but not in France, also not in Germany, in Prussia at least, in the state of Prussia. Now, his economic analysis of this manual system was this. He said, now assume you have the manual system and assume that if you have a large plot of land and you invest, let's say, 1 million rupees on the land, this gives you a huge increase. So it is really very profitable from a social point of view. The investment is very profitable, it's highly profitable. But because the law provides that the lord of the manor gets 50% of the crop and the sharecropper gets also 50% of the crop, nobody has an incentive to invest the whole investment. Only if it is extremely, if the return are extremely high. You see what I mean? So you get an underinvestment as a consequence of this system. Also, it was not possible for the lord of the manor to take up a credit because he could not pledge away his land. The land had to be the only legal way of a transfer of the title of land under the manor system was to inherit it to the heir, which was usually the eldest son. But you could not sell it, you could not pledge it, because if you pledge it and then cannot pay, then the bank must have the possibility to take the land, of course, and then sell it off. That was not possible. And this, in the 18th century in Europe, led to an undercapitalization of agriculture and an underdevelopment of agricultural credit. And now something that this is German history, I don't know whether you're interested, but it, I think it's still a nice example. We had, there was a war, a 7 years war in which also England and France were part and so on, but I don't go into that details. But this war especially devastated one Prussian province, the province of Silesia, because several campaigns were fought in Silesia, so the whole province was badly devastated. Now, after the war, the Prussian king had no money, you know, there was no money, no credit, nothing. So what he did was, he allowed, by way of an executive order, not by way of normal law, by way of executive order, he allowed for a particular period, I think of 30 or 40 years, he allowed the lords of the manor to pledge away their land, which was before not and otherwise not possible. So they could pledge away their land and could take up a credit. And within no time, mortgage banks were established there in this province, and within 20 years, the whole province was again flourishing. Everything was built up by way of private market initiative, only because now the land could be pledged away, and those who would not pay, you must give up their land. Pardon? Yeah, it was possible to pledge it away, but as long as the manual system existed, that did not affect the rights of the laborers. Only the landlord had to give up his position and was then replaced by another landlord with the same rights. See what I mean? this sharecropping system, you know, that was also shortly later abolished in Europe, in the French Revolution first, and then a couple of years later in almost all European states. I come to that a little later, because the economists at that time, Adam Smith and Quinet and so on, they had a very, very good understanding of how the law affects this. For instance, Quinet, François Quinet, he wrote a very influential article in this encyclopedia. The first encyclopedia ever written was by Diderot, you know, that was the Enlightenment movement. And they said that in Europe, people do not have access to the new knowledge we have. So we have to collect all the new knowledge in an encyclopedia. That was the first encyclopedia, which had a very high philosophical motivation behind it. And Quinet, he wrote an article in this encyclopedia of Diderot called Grains, simply Grains, in which he makes this argument. He said the sharecropping system is unjust, but Quinet criticized this not because it is unjust, but because it destroys our agriculture. It leads to undercapitalization, it makes the whole country poor, and therefore it has to be abolished. So he fully understood not only the injustice, I mean, it doesn't take much to understand this, but the injustice of the system, but the inefficiency of the system, you see? Now comes a tragic example. Egertsen is an institutional economist, and I came to know him on a conference, and we had lunch together. He is a professor of economics at the Icelandic University of Reykjavik. Reykjavik is the capital of Iceland. And he told me a really interesting story. Now, Iceland is a very small country by all standards. Not if you look at the map, it looks not so small. But if you look at the number of people, they have 325,000 people in Iceland. That's the whole population today. And in the Middle Ages, it was a little less, but not much less. So that was the population, basically. Now, what these people did was they produced basically sheep, cattle on grazing land, and they produced grains, all kinds of grains, like wheat, for instance. And they lived quite well from this. There were no problems. They had a high culture. You know, all these tales, the Lord of the Rings and so on, which you all know, the original texts were written by Icelandic people originally. And they had the Viking ships and so on. But in the 17th century, temperature in Europe, I don't know whether that was the same in India, but in Europe, temperatures went down by 3 to 4%. There was a climate change. It was not dramatic, but we call it, in Germany, we call it the Little Ice Age. So temperatures went down. They went also down in Iceland, with the effect that this had reduced the productivity of agriculture markedly. Now Egertsen, I have later read his book, but he told me over lunch, he said, you know, when this happened, normally that should not be a problem, not have been a problem at all, because Iceland is an island and it has the richest fishing grounds in the whole of Europe around the island. So what these Icelandic people should have done and could have done in principle was simply to build some small ships, you know, row into the sea, and they could have collected the fishes and sold them and salt them. The technology was there to salt the ship and preserve the fish, preserve them and sell them to Europe and import whatever they need. So they could, if only a relatively small part of the workforce would have specialized in fishing, that might not have been a problem. But that did not happen. And why did it not happen? It did not happen because the powerful in the country did not want it, because it was against their interests. Now, why is it in the interest of the powerful to keep a country poor? Now, Egertsen writes in his book that at the time, 1650, 1660, when these problems became pressing, more than 70% of all arable land in Iceland was owned by 50 families, by only 50 families. 50 families, 50, 60 families owned almost all of the land. Now, for the economist of you, this might be easy. For the non-economist, might be a little more difficult, what the connections now. What does that mean? Sorry, I have to stand here because I'm sorry. if, let's say, one third of the workforce had worked in fishing, then this means that their wages, their real wages, would be pretty high. This would also increase the real wages in agriculture, because of course there is one wage basically for a similar work. And given now the low productivity of agriculture as a consequence of climate change, this would have reduced the value of the land substantially. Therefore, the landowners, they did not want this. They wanted cheap labor on their land. So what they did, they monopolized in Iceland, they monopolized the parliament. They had a kind of parliament there, and they issued a law according to which every person in Iceland has to take up his homestead, that is his living place, on a farmstead. Everyone has to live on a farm within the confines of the farm. And this law nailed down the labor force on the farms. So the people, instead of moving to the high productivity jobs, were kept in the low productivity jobs, had wages which made them starve, only to protect the wealth of the landowners. See what I mean? Now, at that time, the country, the Kingdom of Denmark, had a kind of imperial oversight on Iceland. You know, it is, they did not rule the country. The country had its own had an autonomous state, but Denmark had a kind of oversight of on Iceland, and the Danish administration at the time did not understand what was going on. They did not understand the problem. They simply saw that the Icelandish people were starving, and at time around the year 1700, the Danish kingdom, they had plans to evacuate all Icelanders to Denmark and settle them there, because they said otherwise they will starve, and they had no theory behind this which explains why they starved. that you just had to change the residential rules, the residential laws, and Iceland would have flourished and became a power, a sizable fishing industry. But that did not happen. A similar thing is presented, similar research has shown this when it comes to the abolition of serfdom in France and in Prussia. And this leads me now, this example which I give you now, leads me to a new idea and a very important idea, and an idea which is central for legal reforms and economic reforms. Now, both in France and in Prussia, Prussia was the biggest German state then at the time, serfdom and the sharecropping was abolished, right? And we have already seen the reason why sharecropping, in a situation in which it was necessary to invest heavily in the agriculture, why that was necessary to abolish it. But to abolish it was also difficult, because it was not in the interest of the lords of the manor. You know, the noble people were against it. So you have stiff opposition against a legal reform which increases the wealth of the nation, because you have losers in the system. So to make a country richer does not imply that everybody becomes richer, but it only implies that, you know, the average income goes up, but you might have winners and losers. And here, the noble people were the losers. Now I tell you what happened in the French Revolution. When the French Revolution started, one of the first decisions of the French Parliament was to abolish serfdom and to abolish the sharecropping system. So the what they did was they abolished the serfdom, and the farmers, you know, the serfs, they could stay on the plots which they had operated before, but they did not have to give away anything of their crop. But at the beginning of the French Revolution in 1789 and 90, the moderates dominated the French Parliament, and they said, well, the serfs, they get now the undivided private property of their land, but they must compensate the nobility for their lost earnings. So they had to pay 5% of the value, of the discounted value of the lost earnings, as a, you know, as a cash payment every year. And that made this reform, let's say, less divisive. You can say, well, this is a foul compromise or something. I know what you think, now, foul compromise. But without this, you would have all the people dead in the street. So that was the rationale which made this swift reform possible. It is not nice. It is not, you know, the money goes from the poor to the rich, but the economic efficiency gains are still there, you know, because now you don't have this distortion of incentives. Now you have an incentive for everybody to invest on the land as much as it is profitable. Now then, the French, during the French Revolution, the political system radicalized, you know, and the majority in parliament shifted from the moderates to the radical, to the so-called sans-culottes, and the sans-culottes, and the, there's another name, I'm just forgetting this, one of the sans-culottes, and they, in 1793, they abolished this, you know, this 5% payment. And this had such a divisive effect on in France that it took many decades, you know, to bring the French people together again. And even in 1850, that is 60 years after these reforms, after these radical reforms and divisive reforms, the French agriculture per capita, per acre, was only 44% of that in England. Because, you know, it was so disruptive. There were big costs of disruption. Now, in Prussia, on the contrary, which was not a, Prussia was, you know, more a conservative, you could even say reactionary country, but they also saw, you know, these Prussian reformers in the state government, they saw, we must abolish this system. It is inefficient, but we have to abolish it in a way without losers. There should be no losers. So what they did was, they said, okay, the serfs, we abolish serfdom totally, the serfs become owners, but they have to compensate the lord of the manors, and if they cannot compensate, and most of them could not, had not the money or no access to credit, then they lose some of the land, up to 50% of the land they lost. So this was again not very just in a way, but it made it possible, you know, otherwise the stiffness, the stiff opposition of the nobility might have blocked this altogether. So what the what these reformers had in mind is something very, very important. They saw that there is a legal change is possible. The legal change comes with huge returns for the economy and also for the people concerned, but there are some losers. So we find a way to compensate the losers and make, you know, make the reform, as the economists say, a reform without losers, or in other words, we call it Pareto improvement. A Pareto improvement in economics is a change of the system in which at least one person is better off, but nobody is worse off. And if you have this situation, then the stiffness of opposition is lower than in a reform which is which makes many people better off, but some much worse off, for instance. Then you get often stiff opposition and the reform never happens. So this agricultural reform in Prussia, by, you know, abolishing serfdom without producing losers, was very successful. In the 300 years before these reforms, the Prussian agricultural productivity per worker did not change. I mean, we have not very reliable data, but the data we have tell us that it did the agricultural productivity per worker and also per unit of land did not change. And in the 50 years after, it increased by 50%. So that was quite remarkable. And this is the idea behind reforms without losers, which is not always something which we want to to have. Now, let me sum up a little bit. It's the prototype of a joint stock company in Venice, or it might be detrimental for the economy, like the the legal norm which obliged every man and every woman to take up his home at the farmstead. But what is even more important is that if you want to change the legal system or legal norms which increase wealth, which are wealth increasing, you often have losers. And if these losers are very powerful in the system, they might obstruct the reform, and then you get nowhere. And that is the deeper reason why many countries cannot move from A to B, from a situation in which, you know, there is, let's say, starvation, to another situation in which there is no starvation. That is the deeper reason. So it is a fundamental idea to look at legal reforms and to look at how successful reformers overcame this problem of cushioning and of silencing the losers by buying them out, sometimes buying them out. Okay, now I want to... Yes, yes. What? Yes, it's very, very difficult. You know, I know this from Europe. We have this problem in Europe, not in Germany, but in Greece. Pardon? Yeah, but especially we have it in Greece, where, you know, Greece has this problem with the euro and so on. And in Greece, taxis are very heavily licensed. I mean, they are licensed everywhere. They are licensed also in Germany. You cannot drive a taxi without license. But in Germany, the license is worth nothing. So if anybody wants to sell his shop, his taxi shop, then the part of the license goes to close to zero. So there is just a license is not a problem. But in Greece, a license, before the crisis of 2010, a taxi license was worth 200,000 to 300,000 euros. So they created an artificial monopoly by licensing. I mean, that is what you know, that in India, the whole Indian system was partly based on licenses. But that's what the way they did. And consequently, I mean, this has huge consequences. The first consequence is that taxi drivers in Greece, they are part of a kind of working aristocracy with very high income. They earn more money than, for instance, a school teacher in high school. You know, they are, in Germany, the taxi drivers, they are basically people of the lower middle class. Here they are of the middle or even higher middle class. So this is one thing. Then the usual way the Greek taxi drivers care for their old age is that when they are 65 or so, they sell off their taxi, get 300,000 euros for it, and then can live with 300,000 euros for the rest of their life, you see? Now, the downside of all this is, of course, that taxi prices are extremely high. And then it also brings corruption into the system. So for instance, typically Greece, we have now the Olympic Games. So if a Greek sports person wins the gold medal, let's say, in the Olympic Games, then the state gives him a taxi license. Yeah, that's the way the system works, you know. And of course, that is extremely difficult to change. I was in Greece in 2012, 2 years after the crisis, and I gave a talk because I've also published on this Euro crisis, and I gave a talk there in Athens. And so I took a taxi from the airport. I asked the driver, and so what, can you tell me what your license is worth now? Oh, he said, we have lost almost everything. 65,000, he said, is still worth. So it went down from 300 to 65,000. I mean, this is a big loss, and these people are really, you know, they fight like hell against this. So that is a good example of why such reforms, even though they are in principle good, are so difficult to achieve, you know, to abolish a licensing system. You have, as a politician, you make only enemies and some few lukewarm friends, because the benefits are distributed equally among the whole population. You pay lower fares for the taxi, so prices go down a little bit. But for these people, the income loss is extreme, you know, the income and wealth loss. That makes it so difficult. In the world, which were very poor 100 years ago and are very rich today. That is Japan. Japan started earlier, the reform started even earlier. But before 1866, the Meiji reforms, Japan was very, very poor. And, you know, Singapore, Korea, Taiwan were very, very few, very poor countries, extremely poor, much poorer even than in Africa. Africa, in the year 1957, the average per capita income in Africa was higher than in East Asia, with the exception of Japan. You know? And these countries have made it from this lowest possible level and are now among the highest countries. You know, I was in Taiwan. I have later this year, I'm a visiting professor at the National Law School in Taiwan, and I've been there before, and also in South Korea. You know, these are countries with an opulence. You cannot believe it. It is totally unbelievable if you think that these countries have been the poorest in the world. Now, if you read the literature about these countries and about how they got so rich, then the people who are knowledgeable about these countries, they say they don't give a benchmark or so. They don't say you must do it so and so. But they say that all the political leaders understood one thing, which is absolutely necessary for success. That growth processes must not be too divisive, that you must try to have an all-inclusive process which leaves nobody behind too much. You know, it is inevitable if you have growth, you have more income, inequality, all these things, these are unavoidable. But what you cannot do, and what will fire back badly, if over a long period of time you have winners and losers, that is not possible. So all these people, you know, these political leaders in these countries, they understood this, and they made sometimes a politics or whatever that is different from country to country, which compensated losers. You see? Now, this is a, you know, this graph here, that is from the book Solomon's Knot, you know, this book here, which I wrote together with Bob Kuta from Berkeley, from the University of Berkeley. Now, when I, this is the per capita income of Latin American countries. And, you know, when we had first a look at this, we couldn't believe it. We simply could not believe this. Now, I must come back to the theory which I gave you. Now, there was the theory of state-led growth. State-led growth, you know, you have a huge public sector, telecommunication, railways and so on, steel, coal and so on. Everything is owned by the state, like in India, you know. And then the experience was that this state-led growth did not work very well. And that led to the Washington Consensus. And the Washington Consensus said market economy. Privatize, you know, sell all this off to the private sector, liberalize, and so on. That was the market. Now, here, this year is the year 1980, when the reforms, when these liberal reforms were introduced. This was the time before the liberal reforms, under state-led growth. And then here, so this is a new development, but look here at the development from 1980 to 2005, let's say. Then you find here in all Latin American countries that the introduction of the free market system, the totally unfettered market, has not increased, but decreased the growth. So you would expect that it would go this way and not this way. So these countries had better economic performance under the old-fashioned socialist system or quasi-socialist planning system than under the free market system. Now, when I came up with this data, we discussed it. Bob Kuta and I discussed it. We said, how is that possible? And I mean, he's very much like me, pro-market. It's not that we are against the market. But we then screened the literature. And in the literature of Latin American scholars, you can read that they say that this period between 1980 and 2000 were two lost decades. Latin America lost two decades. Why? Now, our explanation in the book is that in Latin America, you simply had a lot of planning, and then when you abruptly move from planning to market economy, and you have not the institution of the market, you have no investor protection, you have no protection of contracts, no protection of property, then the system does not work. You have to have institutions in place. And these institutions, they were badly damaged in the times of socialism and of planning, and then you had a kind of gangster capitalism, you know, where similar to the Soviet Union after the to Russia after the in the oligarchic system, in which nothing works, and therefore, as long as you don't have the institutions in place, you cannot do such a thing.
Taking place on its own.
Yeah, well, that is true, but you know, the research, the economic research on this system was led to similar conclusions worldwide, because this development, you say, oh, well, this is not so bad. That's what you say. So why should we change it? No, this is not so bad if you compare it to this, but it is very bad if you compare it to other countries at the same time. You see? Got the point? So only gradually they understood in Latin America that, you know, it doesn't help the economy if, for instance, a public television or a public TV company is sold off, you know, for bargain price to a private investor. So, for instance, the Mexican, to give you just one example, during these reforms, privatize, liberalize, and so on, the Mexican state sold off the Mexican telecom company for the price of $1.8 billion to a private investor after an international accounting firm had estimated the value of the company at $10 to $12 billion. So there's a difference between the price which the investor paid and the real value of the company of $10 billion. That is, the investor who makes that deal has $10 billion, and with that money you can buy everybody, you know, from the head of the state to the last civil servant who is dealing with that. You see, and this was these things happened very often in Latin America. Or now, you know, you have this the problem in Brazil. I have just a student in Hamburg who writes his thesis, a master thesis, on Petrobras. And that was a state-owned company which was which went public, you know, it was privatized. But the privatization, by the privatization, the control, the public control was diminished, so that the parties and powerful groups in the state had more control over it, not less control. And this student of mine, he shows exactly how the privatization reduced the value of the company, not increased the value. Before the privatization, the company was a company share was worth 24 pesos, or what the local currency is, and it went down to 11. So all these cash flow goes into the coffers of politically influential people. You know, that is the problem if you don't have institutions. And then if you don't have this, if you cannot protect the investor who owns the shares, then you cannot have rapid or good growth. And this is different, at least partly different, in China. I come to that a little later.
And Argentina was one of the richest countries.
Yes.
And these countries, the Spanish had ruled over there, but they have got their freedom in the mid 1850s, much before what happened in Asia.
Yeah, yeah, yes. Yes, you know, I mentioned Korea, South Korea. Now, in the year 1900, that is 115 years ago, in the year, we have the data, in the year 1900, the per capita income of Argentina was five times that of Korea. Five times. And today, the per capita income of Korea is five times that of Argentina. You know, here you have the equivalent data for the countries, and you see, when you look at the big countries, that is even more pronounced. You know, here you have, this is here Argentina, and then this is here Mexico, this is Chile, Brazil, and there's only one. However, important outlier in Latin America, that is Chile, you know, this yellow line. Chile has, in the meantime, has become richer than all countries. So here I have the latest data. These are the updated, and you see that Chile has now surpassed all other countries. And it is well known that Chile is the country with the best legal system in Latin America. It's the least corrupt country, the country with the best functioning courts and so on. Even though it has problems, I was just 4 weeks ago, I was in Chile at the Latin, I'm still a member of the board of the Latin American Association of Law and Economics, which was in Chile this year in Santiago. And we had a discussion with judges from the Supreme Court there, and so the overall impression I got is that Chile, in spite of its problem, is the best country in Latin America economically. Now, this is also interesting. Let me just see. This is the updated version of it. Now, we have here two groups of countries and their capita income from 1990 to 2013, yes. So the dotted line are the 12 countries of the former Soviet Union, which did not become part of the European Union. And the other, this line here, this bright line, are the eight new EU members, the countries which became members of the EU. That is especially the Baltic states, Lithuania, Estonia, but also Poland, Hungary, the Czech Republic, Slovakia, these are the countries, Hungary, these are these countries. And this is basically Russia, the Ukraine, Belorussia, and some other former Soviet republics. Now what you see here is something quite interesting, that you have, for both these groups, you have a U shape. You know, after the collapse of communism, incomes went down. But then after a couple of years, we have an upturn again. And in the countries which later joined the EU, this upturn is much more pronounced. You know, I have it here also. Here, this is even a little, here it becomes more precise, but this goes only until 2008. So the blue line is the eight new EU member countries, the red line, the 12 non-EU post-Soviet countries. So, for instance, in Russia, I think it took until 2007 that the country achieved again a per capita income, the per capita income of the Soviet period, of 1989, when at the end of the Soviet period. Now, when one asks for the reasons of this difference, then here one can say that law plays a big role. Let's say Poland, Hungary, they abolished the communist system and they wanted to become members of the EU. And to become member of the EU, they have to fulfill the so-called Copenhagen criteria, rule of law and so on. And this was all imposed on these countries by the EU. They did not only say, oh, well, fine and so on. They really checked whether, for instance, law enforcement was improved and that the courts were independent, all these kind of things. They were steadily controlled by the EU. And the countries, these countries like Poland, they did not in any way protest against this because that's what they wanted. They were, even though there were groups who were against this, who were losers, these reforms could be carried through. And so after a very relatively short period of time, these countries could recover again and became and had an economic miracle. Now, in 1989, the last year of the Soviet period, Poland had a per capita income which was only 35% of that of Germany. Now, today, this year, the Polish per capita income is 67% of that of Germany. So they really had a race, and if that goes on like this, another one generation, then they are on the same equal footing as Germany. And this is certainly a result of a massive improvement of the of the legal system. Again, I repeat what is necessary: protect investors, enforce contracts, protect property, establish workable company law. These are the crucial things, you know, and that happened here, and that explains the relative, you know, positive development. Whereas in Russia, something happened which one can only call a tragedy, a real, true tragedy. Because the Russians had this, you know, the Soviet communism broke down in 1989. It broke down at a time when the Washington Consensus was still the general overriding theory, you know, the Washington Consensus. Privatize, liberalize, and so on, without taking any notice of the presence or non-presence of institutional factors. That is, this wrong theory was in the heads and minds of the most influential advisors to the Soviet, to the new Russian government. So what they said, you must now, in one step, in 100 days, they had a plan, 100-day plan. In 100 days, you go from communism to the market economy.